Welcome. We're going to start our lecture now. Today's lecture will do what we normally do, which is to build upon the topics we've been investigating over the previous weeks. The students who've been attending and listening in regularly have been learning about the transformation of energy on all the different levels of nature, and also about the Noble Eightfold Path, which is the basic structure of the path to liberate oneself from suffering. The Noble Eightfold Path is one of the core elements of Buddhism. And that Eightfold Path is known and studied and practiced in many different forms of Buddhism around the world. But that path is also a universal aspect of every religion, even if it isn't called that Eightfold Path. But we find those eight steps also in Christianity, in the Sermon on the Mount given by Jesus. And we find all the same elements, the same guides and indications given in all the different religious traditions around the world. And this is, of course, one of the great powers or great truths that we discover when we investigate Gnosis. And that is that religion is one. The teachings are one thing. They are one science. And that science has been known in different names, in different faces, in different places, and at different times. What's essential for the student is to penetrate beyond the names and faces, to within themselves, within their own heart, mind, and action, to activate and live the guides and rules that are given in all those teachings. And it's only in that way that the student becomes what's called an adept. In the beginning, a student is studying and trying to understand. And in Latin, this person is called imitatus, which means one who imitates. And this is a necessary part of the process. We know that when we grow up as children, we are imitatus, because we imitate our parents, our siblings, our friends, our neighbors. And through that process of imitation, we develop the skill of behavior in all the different manifestations and aspects that we need in life. That same process is engaged in the spiritual path. In the beginning, we are imitatus. We learn from our teachers, from the different books and traditions that we study, how to behave, how to act. That process of imitatus requires a great deal of sincerity. Many students come into spiritual teachings filled with pride, believing that they already know, believing very much in themselves. And this immediately puts them at a disadvantage. Believing that they are adeptus, they refuse to take on the role of imitatus. And because of that, they fail to grow. I mention this at the beginning of this lecture because this lecture can sound very simple. This lecture may sound like something you've heard a million times before. But until one takes it seriously in oneself and learns how to behave properly, one does not accomplish the necessary process of being imitatus, which is to learn proper behavior. And until we learn proper behavior, we cannot become a real adept. And I hope that that will become clear through the course of this lecture. In all the different traditions around the world, when we investigate the various scriptures, we consistently find certain elements and certain teachings which are present everywhere. The Eightfold Path is one. But in addition to that, we find that there's a great deal of discussion, a great deal of indication of the importance of the word. The word, of course, is the way of speech that we have. The word is the vibration. It is sound. It is energy. And many of us may know from the study of Scripture that the word is central in the creation of all things. When we investigate the Christian or Hebrew texts, such as the Bible, we find the word, or the logos, is a central element in all forms of creation. So in the book of John, we find this passage, which is quite famous, which begins, "In the beginning was the word." This phrase has a great depth of meaning, and it's often misunderstood. Obviously, when we study Kabbalah, we're studying the word itself. And word in Greek is logos. And of course, the entire tree of life is an unfolding of the solar logos, or that solar word or verb. But we investigate other traditions, we find that same idea, which is the word as the power of creation. When we look into the Egyptian tradition, we find this scripture that says, "I, Osiris, brought my own name into my mouth as a word of power, and I forthwith came into being." So Osiris also creates himself through the word. Osiris is the Christ. In the Hindu traditions, in the Satapatha Brahmana, we find this: "In a year, he, Prajapati," who's the Lord, the Father, "desired to speak. With his mouth, he created the gods." So again, we have the expression of verb, of word, as that creative force. And also in the Mayan scriptures, it says, "This is the beginning of the ancient word, the potential and source for everything done." So the word, the verb, the power of the throat, is at the root of creation itself. All of these scriptures affirm the same thing, that God, that divinity, the Logos, who is word, creates through the power of the throat. So when we understand as a Gnostic student that in the macrocosm, in the grand scheme of things, creation is implemented through the power of the voice, what about the microcosm? What about us? Now you may begin to understand why I said in the beginning that this is something you may think you've heard a million times before. But I encourage you to consider this very deeply. If God creates through the power of his voice, through the power of speech, what about us? We who are dedicated to becoming his reflection, to being created in his image, we too create through the power of the voice, through our speech, through our word. This is why when we study the Eightfold Path, one of the cardinal rules or cardinal steps of that Eightfold Path is right speech. And this is not merely a moral or ethical guideline. It is that. In the same way that the Ten Commandments say that we should not lie. The use of the verb, the use of our language, the use of speech, is actually a sacred thing. When we examine the total picture of this world of Malkut, this physical world, the kingdom, we see that one of the primary distinguishing characteristics of our particular group of beings is the use of language. The word is one of the distinguishing factors that separates this humanoid kingdom from the three lower kingdoms. Now, other creatures communicate. There's no question about that. But the means and method is different. And in the humanoid kingdom, we were given a capacity to use speech, to use language, to use the verb, which is not something to be taken lightly. This form of exterior communication is really the reflection of an interior intelligence or an interior language or interior dialogue. What we say, what we speak, reflects who we are. Now, Plato expressed in one of his books a famous line, which says this: "Be it known unto you, my dear Crito, that speaking in an improper manner is not only committing a fault in what is said, but also a type of damage which is caused to the soul." What Plato is indicating is that when we use language in the wrong way, not only do we corrupt the concept that we're expressing, but we corrupt the souls of men. The verb, or the word, is a vibration, an energy that emanates out from our throat. But that energy, that vibration, is the expression of something inside. Now, when we look at energy, in the same way we've examined it over the past few weeks, we understand that energy and matter are closely related. We also understand that energy produces results. In every level of nature, an expression of energy or any force that's directed in a particular way will produce a reaction. That's a law of nature. Our speech is subject to that same law. When we speak a word, we are producing an action. And that action, as follows in all of nature, will produce a consequence or a result. However, most of us probably don't really understand the true nature of action and consequence related to our speech, related to our words, how we talk, what we say, how we say it. We know that a very loud sound can destroy things. Just the vibration. We've all heard of people that have a quality of voice that can break glass when they sing a certain note. Or if there's a large explosion, the sound, the vibration, can break glass, can break things. A sonic boom can knock over trees, just from that vibration. So at that extreme level, we see the movement of physical matter caused by sound. But sound in itself is a vibration that can cause results that are not readily visible to the sight. In the same way that sound can move physical matter, a word can kill. Something that we say can kill someone else. A doctor, for example, is a very clear example of that. A doctor, in treating a patient, if that doctor says, "Oh, you're going to get better," but they say it without believing it, with the knowledge that the patient will definitely die, the patient will hear that. The patient will hear what's behind the words. Will hear that the doctor knows that they're not going to live and that patient will die. Now, the doctor doesn't really know, because the doctor is not God. The doctor has a belief or an idea based on his training that the patient is more likely to die than live. But that belief, that feeling, is expressed in spite of the words he uses. So that speech, that verb, has the power to kill. And that same power is within all of us. The way we speak to one another has the power to radically alter another person's life. We speak in a certain way and we can produce anger in someone else. We can say the same words with another tone and we can generate happiness in someone else. So it's not merely the words we choose, it's how we use them that becomes important. When we study the Eightfold Path, one of the steps is right speech. And we looked previously at how those eight aspects of the Eightfold Path can really be broken into three groups: view, action, and meditation. We've discussed view a little bit already. View is how we see, how we perceive, which is something very profound. Action is about how we behave, how we do what we need to do in order to activate and live the Eightfold Path in ourselves. And one of the aspects of action is right speech. When we study the Buddhist scriptures, the Buddha himself said, "What is right speech?" Right speech is refraining from lying, refraining from slander, refraining from harsh speech, and refraining from frivolous speech. So the first one the Buddha mentions is lying. To lie is something we learn to do very well when we're children, because we learn to imitate. We learn how to lie from our parents. Our parents lie because they don't want us to know things or believe things or see things, which we know and see and believe very easily anyway. Moreover, we know very well that our parents lie to us. But when we become parents, we forget all that and we continue lying to our children, and we teach them how to lie. In the scriptures, it says this: a liar lies to himself as well to the gods. Lying is the origin of all evils. It leads to rebirth in the miserable planes of existence, to breach the pure precepts, and to corruption of the body. That's from a Buddhist sutra, the Maharatnakuta, something like that. So we see that lying is the origin of, rather than evil, I think the translation would be better, suffering. A lie is a cause of suffering. And when we study Gnosis, we study a famous lecture given by the master, Samyutta Nikaya, called Alcyon. And in that lecture, he says that negative emotions turn everyone into liars. Knowing and understanding Gnostic psychology, we understand that we ourselves have created this ego or this mind that we're so burdened with. And that ego is trapping, enclosing 97% of our consciousness. And that cage is made up of pride and fear and anger and envy and jealousy, etc. And all of those elements are what we would call negative emotions. Pride is a negative emotion. It feels good. We believe in ourselves, we feel good about ourselves, but it's pride. And that causes us to be a liar. When we believe too much in our egotistical selves, forgetting the being, forgetting our own inner God, that is pride. And that causes us to feel that negative emotion of self-sufficiency, or alternatively shame or self-hate, which is another form of pride, it's another face of pride. And that sense, that feeling, that negative emotion makes us a liar, because we say, I feel this, I am this, or I am not. Those are all lies. The truth is the being. But we don't experience that truth. We experience our false personality and our own ego. So when we pass through the varying events of our lives, through all the circumstances of life, we have in our heads a voice that's always there telling us that we are right and everyone else is wrong. That's pride. And that I is lying. So the lie begins in the heart and in the mind. The lie is not limited simply to something spoken aloud. The lie begins inside, in the chatter, in that stream of thinking that's always processing in us. So in synthesis, we are all liars. And as a result, we are creating suffering. Not only for ourselves, but for everyone around us. And of course, our society greatly encourages this kind of pride. To believe in yourself, to believe in your dreams, to be proud of your race, to be proud of your country. These are all lies. They are all divisive. They seek to divide people, to make distinctions. And separation or separateness is one of the great heresies. It's one of the great crimes against divinity. To create divisiveness among people is a crime. We lie when we affirm what we do not know. This is a very difficult thing to manage. To not affirm what we do not know. Because we have the habit of affirming things that we do not know. We hear something, a friend tells us a story, and then we repeat the story as if we know it. We don't know it. We heard it from someone, and it could be a fabrication. The entire thing could be a lie. And yet we assume and accept it as real, and we propagate the story further. Much of our family history is like that. Much of what we've been told by our parents is what they were told, and it's all lies. Much of our cultural history is like that. Much of the history that we know about past figures is actually lies written by their enemies, but only the lies survived, so now we believe those lies. And we believe, for example, that Nero is a homosexual. It's a lie. But everybody believes that because his enemies wrote it down, and that's all that survived. And so now everybody believes that. Nobody knows it, but everybody believes it. And so everyone who repeats that story is a liar. To clarify that in oneself is very difficult. The Gnostic student faces this problem on a daily basis because we study Gnosis, we study religions, and we have to be very careful about affirming things that we do not know. It's a tricky balance because as a Gnostic student, we need to develop faith. We need to develop that enthusiasm to comprehend the great truths. But the ease of which we can enter into fanaticism is astonishing. And it's so easy to affirm things that we've read, but that we do not know. And that is how a fanatic is born. That is how the Pharisee in us is strengthened, when we affirm things that we do not know. We also lie when we assume. And this is also very subtle. A friend of mine was telling me a good story that relates to this. She was doing something in her house, cleaning. And her husband said, "Why are you doing things like that?" And the woman said, "I'm doing it that way because I think it's right. It's the way I want to do it." She was offended. And the husband said, "Why are you acting like that? I was just asking, why are you doing it like that? Because I haven't seen that before and I want to understand why you're doing it that way." So you can see that the woman was offended because she assumed that he was criticizing her, but he wasn't. So her mind was lying. Her mind improperly transformed that impression and added an assumption to it, a wrong transformation. And as a result, she spoke in anger and frustration. And that was a lie. But we do that all the time. We believe the chain of ever-flowing thoughts that we hear inside of our heads. We believe that that voice that we hear inside is always telling us the truth. Well, I feel this and that, and they should have said that, and I can't believe this happened to me, and I didn't deserve it, and they shouldn't have done this and that, and I can't believe those people. All lies. But we believe it. And so our problems really begin there, inside. We compound the problem when we speak those lies aloud. And we create karma. Now, lies can be intentional or unintentional. Sometimes we lie and we don't know we're lying. Sometimes we lie and we know it. Either way, we're creating karma. We're creating consequences that we will have to suffer through. So it's to our advantage to carefully observe the chatter that's processing from moment to moment inside of our own mind. To learn to discriminate a lie from the truth. To learn how to doubt one's own thoughts. We also have to apply that same technique to things that we hear, to the speech we hear from others, to stories, to ideas, to concepts, to gossip. Just because someone says it does not make it true. What's harder is if something is written, we think it's more true. And if something's in a book, then it must be true. Right? Somehow there's these gates or boundaries that we have in relation to truth. And if I tell you something, you might believe it. But if I write it down, you're more likely to believe it. But if you read it in a published book, you are almost certainly going to believe it. It's the same words. But we have a habit. How we transform those impressions. We need to become aware of that. The vast majority of the books that exist on this planet are full of lies. Why? Because they were written by people who are identified with negative emotions. I think that we'd all be astonished to pick up some books from about 100 years ago on science and read them. We'd probably laugh because the vast majority of what was being written at that time we now know is all garbage. But at that time, everybody believed it as God's truth. The theories, the ideas, the concepts were accepted and propagated as the absolute law of nature. But nowadays, we don't believe that anymore. So what is truth? And if that was true then, it's certainly true now. That a great deal, a large percentage of what we as a community and a culture and a society believe is true is actually not. And this is true in politics, it's true in science, it's true in religion. A large percentage of what we are receiving in our educational systems and receiving in our cultural upbringing is really all lies. The majority of our history, the majority of our science, the majority of our religion. It's lies and beliefs that are being propagated as truths. And we accept those things and we continue to propagate them. And all along, we are all lying because we are affirming what we do not know. This produces karma. The ignorance of humanity is caused by humanity. The suffering of humanity is caused by humanity. It is not a vengeful God punishing humanity. It is the law of karma, teaching humanity how to behave. But humanity does not want to learn. And so the law becomes more severe. When you're raising a child, you teach the child patiently and calmly. If the child does not learn, you become more severe, more disciplined in the effort to teach the child how to understand. And if the child persists in behaving in the wrong way, you have to become more severe in your methods in order to teach. And the same is true with grown-ups. And the same is true with groups of grown-ups, groups of humanoids. We do not learn, so we suffer. Just because a million people believe in something does not make it true. I saw this quote recently, and I think it's very interesting. Just because a million people say a foolish thing, it is still a foolish thing. Just because all the human beings believe that humanity is derived from apes, that we are nothing more than apes who have evolved, that does not make it true. Not too long ago, everybody believed the world was flat. And in the perspective of time, that was not long ago. And not long before that, we all believed that the Earth was the center of the universe and that all the planets and stars rotated around us. So, likewise, much of what we believe now is not true. When we affirm those things, we lie. And we create karma. But of all these forms of lying, what is the worst kind of lie? The worst kind of lie is the lie we tell ourselves. And we lie to ourselves continually. We tell ourselves that we are better than others. We tell ourselves that we have been wronged, that other people have mistreated us, that we deserve better, that life owes us a better job, more money, more respect, more love, a better spouse, a nicer car, a nicer place to live. That is a lie because we do not comprehend karma. According to the law, we get exactly what we deserve. No more, no less. To tell ourselves we deserve better is pride, and it's a lie. It's a negative emotion, which is telling us and encouraging us to believe in something that does not exist. We lie to ourselves constantly, not only with pride, but with anger, with our resentment. We believe someone betrayed us. We believe somebody spoke against us, and we resent them. We're angry with them. That's a lie. We fail to comprehend our karma in that situation. In all likelihood, the situation was reversed with that person in the past. And we performed that action against them. So now we're getting what we deserve. We're getting it back. But instead of comprehending that, accepting it, and understanding it, and changing ourselves, we say, no, I didn't deserve that. They should not have said that. And we call them names. And what do? We continue the cycle of karma. Instead of comprehending the cause, we spin that wheel of recurrence faster. And we complicate it more. So we're building more ego. We're building more suffering for ourselves and the other person. We're deepening suffering. So you can see right speech is not such a simple matter. Right speech is extremely profound because it begins in the mind. Right speech is an expression of our psyche, which is emotional, which is physical, and verbal. In the 60s, there was a scientist in the United States who studied communication. And this very famous study revealed that of the way we communicate with each other, the way we express things and explain things, only 7% is in words. The remaining 93% is in tone and body language. So right speech is about communication, expression, not merely words. It's about the total method by which we express who we are inside. So, understanding that lying is a grave crime, primarily against ourselves, but also against other people, we have to investigate the root of lying. And that root is within our own mind. Lies are produced by negative emotions. And as the Master Samael said, there is nothing worse for our inner development than negative emotion. It is the worst thing, the biggest obstacle for our own development spiritually, is negative emotions. And he explains that when we are overtaken by negative emotion, we have to really try to express ourselves in the best way possible. If we find ourselves in a situation where we're feeling a lot of resentment for another person, very bothered by another person, we have to look sincerely at that feeling. We cannot go along with it. We have to resist it. We have to understand it. That resentment or that discomfort may just be envy. Maybe we're jealous of something that person has. We resent them because they have something we want. So the right way to handle that situation is to say things that favor that person. And when you're overtaken by a negative emotion, there is nothing more difficult to do. When you're really angry with someone, the hardest thing you can do is to say something in favor of them. But that is what we must do. If we express the anger verbally, then that is a clear indication that we believe the anger inside, psychologically. Do you follow that? If the anger is expressed through words, it means that inside we believe the anger and we agree with it, which means we are enthroning negative emotions in our own psyche. There is no consciousness there, no free consciousness. It's ego. That means the being is not there. So as a student of any kind of mystical path, any kind of real aspirant to the path needs to understand that. Anger, pride, envy do not mix with the being. And when we enthrone those emotions in ourselves, the being is not there. You cannot mix God and the devil. They can't live in the same house. You can't serve two masters. We know this. We hear this in all the religions. So we have to decide for ourselves. When the anger arises, the envy arises, who do you align yourself with? Do you fight against the anger or do you listen to it? In order to refrain from lying, we must always tell the truth. The Master Samael says we must always tell the truth at any cost. this is not easy. Why? Because we have pride. To tell the truth often means that we will look bad, or we think we'll look bad, or we're afraid we'll look bad. To tell the truth, to tell the basic reality of the facts, is the primary rule to overcome lying. But clearly, in order to stop lying, you have to first know what the truth is. And to know what the truth is requires meditation. Your intellect on its own will never know the truth. Only the consciousness can retrieve the truth itself. And that is done through meditation. So to conquer lying, one must learn to meditate. And of course, those who persist in lying accrue karma, and they create problems for themselves. Now, incidentally, many people are attracted to Gnosis because they are very drawn by this part of the teaching which demonstrates and shows that there are other levels of reality that we can experience directly. The astral plane, the mental plane. A liar cannot penetrate into the astral plane consciously. A liar cannot create the astral body. Someone who's enthroning negative emotions is wasting emotional energy. And to enter into the world of emotion, the astral plane, you must have emotional energy, and it must be positively charged. And when we lie, and when we listen to our anger, and we love our pride, we do not have that energy, because we're building our pride and our anger with that energy. So we waste it. We build ego. There's no energy left to have astral experiences. There's no energy left to remember our dreams. There's no energy left to investigate directly the truths of those worlds. So lying and negative emotions have to be worked with very directly, very practically, on a daily basis. That is the method within which one gathers the energy required, firstly, to penetrate into those worlds consciously, and secondly, to create the astral body. If we continue to be a slave of our negative emotions, we will not awaken in those worlds. Simple as that. Now, moreover, related to lying, the Gnostic has to learn to not express their opinion. I love that one. I think that's just one of the most beautiful things. Can you imagine not expressing your opinion? Especially nowadays, because it seems like everybody wants to express their opinion, and yet nobody knows what they're talking about. To not express one's opinion is vital. Opinions are subjective. They're not based on truth. They're based on ideas. Usually our opinions are simply things that we heard from somebody else and we repeat it. Isn't that true? Most of what we believe is true is something we just heard from somebody else. And we repeat it. It's an opinion. It's a waste of energy. The Gnostic student has to speak in facts or not speak at all. The second aspect of right speech that the Buddha mentioned is to refrain from slander. And really, this is built upon the understanding of what a lie is. In another scripture, we read this: a person is born with an axe in his mouth. He whose speech is unwholesome cuts himself with his own axe. When a person praises someone who should be blamed or attacks someone worthy of praise, then this man is accumulating evil with his mouth, and this evil will not lead him to happiness. It is little harm if one loses money in gambling with dice, even losing everything, including oneself. But if one bears ill will towards well-conducted ones, it is a greater harm indeed. Insulting men of real worth, bearing ill will in thought and speech, leads to eons upon eons in states of misery. And that's from the Sutta Nipata, which is a Buddhist scripture. Now, in Mesopotamia, which contained this knowledge of Gnosis, any person who falsely accused someone else would be subject to the punishment that that crime requires. What that means is, if I falsely accuse someone else of adultery, and it's discovered that the accusation is false, then I must suffer the punishment for that crime. Now, it seems to me that's a pretty smart way of encouraging people to speak the truth, to have the understanding that what you say about others has consequences. Because karmically it does. But in our society now, we don't recognize that. We feel that freedom of speech gives us the right to criticize whoever we want, whenever we want. Freedom of speech does not imply freedom to attack, freedom to slander. We must never condemn anyone. And I encourage you to consider that. We condemn others in subtle ways. To condemn someone else can be done merely by implying it, merely with a gesture. The tone of our voice can condemn someone. Slander and gossip and calumny have filled the world with pain. Telling jokes about other people, making fun of other people, hurts people. It causes trauma. It creates anger and resentment. Right speech begins with learning to not tell a lie. Slander is a kind of lie. Slander is an expression of pride. When we say so-and-so is an adulterer, so-and-so is wrong, so-and-so is doing this and that, so-and-so is stupid, this person is dumb, this person is an idiot. We fail to remember that inside of that person is a monad. Every humanoid, every being, every creature has divinity inside. And when we direct criticism towards that person, we direct criticism towards that divinity. Not only can we cause a trauma in that humanoid or in that creature, but we offend the divinity inside. And we accrue karma. Slander is a very difficult thing to manage, especially now in our culture, because so much of our humor is now based on belittling other people. A few minutes watching television or a movie or reading any book or magazine will show you that. That the majority of our modern humor is based on ridiculing other people. That's slander. And it's criminal. It's filling the world with bitterness. So consider that. How would you feel if someone said that about you? How would you feel? How do you feel when someone criticizes you? When people are talking badly about you? When people are ridiculing you and making fun of you? It's painful. The Gnostic student has to learn to remember that when those words are charging at the gate of their mouth to express that joke, to express that humor, to tease, or to outwardly ridicule. The Gnostic student must remember how it feels to hear that about oneself. Slander Well, in Buddhism, one of the worst sins that anyone can ever commit is to cause a schism in a spiritual community, or to cause a break or a split. The easiest way to cause a break in a spiritual community is with slander and gossip. And yet, people in Gnosis, people in Buddhism, people in Christianity are engaged in this behavior on a constant basis. Talking badly about other students, talking badly about spiritual leaders, spreading gossip and lies, opinions about things about which they have no knowledge. On the internet and on the phone and in small groups and in conferences and meetings and lectures, people get together and gossip. Oh, I heard this. Did you know so-and-so did this and that? Did you hear about that? Wow, I can't believe it. That's terrible. All lies. None of those people were there. None of those people are involved. And little by little, the story gets changed and made more dramatic and more interesting, which leads to a break, which is headed inevitably towards the destruction of that spiritual community. That is why in Buddhism, it's considered one of the worst sins. The spiritual community, or the Sangha, in Buddhism is considered to be one with the Buddha himself. Because the Sangha, or the spiritual group, is the vehicle of the teaching. How do the teachings of sacred knowledge reach humanity? Through the Sangha, through the community. That community is the expression of that doctrine. It is the messengers of that teaching. None of them are perfect. All of us who are in spiritual communities are loaded with ego, filled with mistakes. Therefore, none of us has the right to criticize anyone else. And yet we all do it. Not one of us is free of the crime of adultery. Not one. Not one of us is free of the crime of murder, the crime of fornication, the crime of stealing, of lying. We are all guilty, equally. And yet we all gossip. We all criticize. We all spread rumors. We all discuss things about which we have no knowledge. And we create breaks and splits in spiritual groups. And this is one of the worst sins. The reason is, when a spiritual group is traumatized, fractured, and split because of gossip, the effectiveness of that group to deliver the teaching is hampered. What better way to keep humanity from hearing the teachings? What could be an easier way to destroy the progress of spiritual knowledge? There is no easier way. There is no better way to obscure the light from men. If you want to destroy a spiritual group, if you want to keep humanity suffering, spread gossip. Spread some slander around. Spread some rumors around, because that is the most effective method. Every spiritual teaching in the history of humanity has been fractured and degenerated because of slander, because of gossip, because of lies. Gnosis is no exception. The Gnostic movement in these times is suffering grave fractures and splits because of politics, slander, gossip, and lies. And of course, all of the students proclaim their innocence. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. I didn't do it. I didn't say anything. It was them. Bingo. You just did it. Pride. It is much easier to tear down a spiritual movement than it is to build one up. It is a very easy thing to destroy a school, to destroy a teaching. However, this should not be confused with the necessity to clarify the teachings. To learn the art of teaching Gnosis, of teaching the truth, whether you call it Buddhism or Christianity or Gnosis or whatever, to teach that well and to not attack groups that teach it wrongly is very difficult. Because to speak the truth, to speak what Gnosis really is, will naturally contradict those groups and teachings which teach the lie, teach things that are not real, teach things that are false. And those students of those groups who are studying and teaching wrong things will claim slander, will claim that they are being attacked. So that the instructor or the student who's teaching Gnosis, who's explaining Gnosis, has to be very careful. The Master Samael Unvior, in one of his books, expressed that in the process of his teaching Gnosis, he had to pay karma for being too direct in clarifying the teachings, because he named names. He indicated, this teacher is teaching something wrong. And there was a form of criticism present there, a form of slander, and he had to pay karma for that. So one has to be very careful to discuss, to teach, to try to understand, but without slander. This is a difficult thing to do. The third aspect of right speech is to refrain from harsh speech. Harsh speech is related to how we use our voice, our tone, the way we express ourselves. Obviously, I'm a bad example. You have to really meditate a lot to understand harsh speech. Obviously, on a superficial language, using crude language, crude words, is very harsh. Using bad words, or language that's filled with negativity, this is harmful. But harsh speech is deeper than that. Irony is a form of harsh speech. To play with words, to produce ironic complications in language, is a form of violence in the mental plane. And nowadays, our humor is very much rooted in this kind of irony. An irony that is seeking to belittle other people and to attack them, and also produce double meanings. Jokes and language that contains double meanings or sexual implications produces fornication in the astral and mental worlds. This is very subtle. But a lot of our humor is based on sexual implication. And this produces fornication in the mind. And obviously, any student who's serious about their path knows that fornication does not simply exist in the physical plane. It's in all the planes of our consciousness, and it must be stopped in all those levels. The way we use our speech can generate fornication in our psychological makeup. The fourth aspect is frivolous speech. Gossip, chit-chat, idle talk. This is an excellent way to waste your life. If you really want to waste your time, just chit-chat. Talk about whatever. And believe me, you will waste a lot of time. And many of us have an addiction to this habit. To just talk and talk and talk about nothing. Everyone is free to do that. But in relation to the Eightfold Path, this is a big obstacle. In the book of Leviticus, in the Bible, it says, you shall not go up and down as a talebearer among your people. To be a gossip, to be a busybody. To hear a story from one person and then, oh, I got to go tell so-and-so, and I really got to, oh, this is a great story. Did you know? Did you hear about this? It's wrong. And yet, how many people do we know who are addicted to that type of behavior? And how many of us are addicted to it? We love a good story. We love it. We love it when we hear something we're not supposed to know. Wow, I can't believe it. I got to call my friend. Did you know? It's wrong. We have to again remember, would we want this said about us? Probably not. And yet, you can guarantee it. If you're saying it about someone else, they're saying it about you. No question about it. It's called karma. It's very simple. Related to all of this, there's an extremely important passage in the Bible, which I strongly encourage you to study and meditate on the meaning. It's very deep. It's in the book of James. And I'm going to read you this little chapter. So I encourage you to listen and consider deeply what's implied and what is said in these words. This is the book of James, chapter 3. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be great, are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on the fire of hell. For every kind of beast, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea, is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue no man can tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. Doth a fountain send forth at the same time sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine, figs? So too can no fountain yield both salt and sweet water. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you, let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. This passage is very clear. No man can tame the tongue, but your being can. So long as you ignore him and enthrone negative emotions, you will remain a slave of that tongue. To conquer that tongue requires self-remembering, meditation. Jesus said, O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you, every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Extremely clear. The use of language, the use of verb, is the basis upon which we work. Because that verb, that speech, begins inside our own psyche. Moreover, when we understand the nature of the secret path, the esoteric knowledge, we know the intimate relationship that exists between the sexual energy and the throat. And in the mere physical level, we see the evidence of that. When in our human organism, we pass through the process of puberty, that sexual energy activates and our voice changes. There is an intimate relationship between the use of sexual energy and the use of the voice. The yogi, the aspirant, who's transforming and transmuting and utilizing the sexual forces, is generating power which fuels the verb, fuels the throat. What that means, anyone, black or white, on the lunar path or the solar path, who's working with sexual energy, is putting more energy into their speech, into their language, into their verb. There's more power. And with power comes more responsibility. Simply put, if you're working with alchemy, if you're working with tantrism, what you say has power. What you speak creates more powerful results than the ones who waste that energy. This is true of a black magician or a white magician, either one. The black magician's harnessing that energy for wrong things, but that energy is fueling their verb with a great deal of power in the wrong direction, but still with power. The one who's working in white tantra is also gathering that power, which fuels the verb. And remember, that verb is not merely spoken. It can be written. It can be implied. So that is a big responsibility. And should be remembered when we speak, when we teach, when we say things, that what comes out of our mouth is creative. But that could be creating destruction or creating life. And that's up to us. One of the most ancient scriptures that is extant today, one of the oldest written documents, in fact, I think it is the oldest written document, as far as my memory serves me. It's called the Laws of Manu, which is an ancient document from India. I believe it's 4,000 to 5,000 years old. It's very old. And in that book it says this, all things are determined by speech. Speech is their root, and from speech they proceed. Therefore, he who is dishonest with respect to speech is dishonest in everything. That has a lot of weight. Moreover, in the tradition of Islam, they say this, the messenger of God took hold of his tongue and said, restrain this. And I said, O prophet of God, what will we say? Will what we say be held against us? And he says, may your mother be bereaved of you. Is there anything that topples people on their faces into hellfire other than the harvest of their tongues? In the I Ching, it says this, where disorder develops, words are the first step. The synthesis of all this is that the Gnostic student needs to learn to control the tongue. And the control of the tongue can only be done when the consciousness is active. If we're asleep, if we're identified with negative emotions, they control the tongue, meaning our pride, our laziness, our gluttony, which means we're producing karma, and we are enchaining ourselves to more and more suffering. The aspirant to the secret path, the one who wants to become free of suffering, the one who walks on the straight path, must learn how to treat everyone the same way. We know this from all the different traditions, to treat others as we would be treated, to love our neighbors as ourselves, etc. It is not enough to have heard that idea. The Bodhisattva treats everyone the same. The one who has become a Bodhisattva has no unevenness in his action. He treats friend and foe the same way, with friendliness, with helpfulness, with care, and with concern, with respect. The Bodhisattva treats rich and poor in the same way, presidents and beggars, the famous and the forgotten, treated with dignity, respect, and concern. In synthesis, this means that in order to refrain from wrong speech, it's not enough to merely think that and believe that and try to control one's language. This is good, but it's not something that can be maintained consistently. It's like many other habits. When we think we should do it, at a certain point we won't, because we're not driven by a real motivation. To think or believe we should not do something is fine, but it isn't sustainable. To really do something, we have to know why we do it, to embody it. And truly, the best way to proceed in the work on oneself, to sincerely and consistently bring about change, is to comprehend how action produces consequences, to comprehend karma, to comprehend suffering. And in reality, that is summed up in one word, bodhicitta, wisdom mind, the mind of compassion. When we understand that the suffering that we undergo is caused by our own action, then we know we need to change those actions. But going deeper than that, when we understand that our actions can make other people suffer in the way we do, we will radically want to change, because we know what suffering feels like. When we really understand what it feels like to be criticized, to have gossip spread about us, to have lies believed about us, then we are at the doorway of true comprehension about our use of speech. When we comprehend that pain, when we see what it feels like when other people talk about us, then we will see we should not talk about others. We will renounce that behavior naturally. There's no false idea in that. There's no posturing, trying to look spiritual. It's a true spontaneous renunciation of wrong speech, because there's comprehension that that action produces suffering. In synthesis, we say, learn to exchange places with others. Put yourself in the shoes of another person, and put the other person in your own shoes. In Mahayana Buddhism, this is one of the fundamental practices that all the practitioners of that tradition learn, how to exchange the self with others. In Gnosis, we learn the same thing. We meditate, exchanging places, reviewing our conduct, and looking to see how our conduct has caused suffering for another person. And when you do that sincerely, believe me, you will not repeat that conduct. This is a very basic aspect of all real traditions, and yet most of us do not practice it. And the reason is because we don't have real comprehension of it. To change, we have to understand why we must change. And that comprehension is a result of understanding action and consequence. In the book, The Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life, it says this: all the joy the world contains has come through wishing happiness for others. All the misery the world contains has come through wanting pleasure for oneself. Real comprehension of that statement puts one squarely on the bodhisattva path. Because one understands, by working on behalf of others, to benefit other people, to stop speaking lies because we know it will hurt others, that is the basis of true spiritual revolution. Many aspirants to the path enter into spirituality to reduce their own suffering. And this is perfectly understandable and necessary. But it is the level of imitatus. It is the very entrance. To actually walk on the path is to achieve the level of adeptus, to be walking under one's own power and by one's own steps. Those steps are driven by comprehension of suffering, how we ourselves produce it, and how we make others suffer. When we understand that, we renounce it. We renounce those behaviors that cause suffering. That idea, that teaching, is present in all religions. In the book of Galatians, we read this: bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. When we slander, we are not bearing another person's burden. When we gossip, we are not bearing their burden. We are adding to it. When we spread lies, when we affirm what we do not know, when we speak harshly, with irony, with criticism, with bad language, we are not bearing the burdens of others. We are adding to those burdens. So the use of speech, the use of language, the use of communication begins in our mind and reflects the contents of our heart. To change that, we have to work directly inside of ourselves, in our hearts and minds. By that, we change our action. In the Talmud, it says the same thing. All men are responsible for one another. The basic idea of the ego is I am separate. I am me, myself, and I want to be recognized as separate, as different, as unique, as better. That's all a lie. That is the heresy of separation. And it's a lie. In truth, we are all deeply interconnected. Not one of us can exist without other people. No one can exist isolated and alone. And this is proven in a thousand different ways. We depend upon one another to survive, to grow, to develop, to live. The idea of being separate and not needing others is a wrong idea and produces wrong speech and produces suffering. The path of the bodhisattva is the full embracing of other people, the complete and spontaneous manifestation of love for others, at the expense of oneself. In Philippians, it says, do nothing from selfishness or conceit, but in humility count others better than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. So we see that the bodhisattva path is taught in every religion. Perhaps veiled, perhaps forgotten, but it's there. The synthesis of that path is expressed in the teachings of Gnosis. To live on behalf of other people. Wrong speech is a manifestation of selfishness. Right speech is a manifestation of compassion. The perfection of right speech is to arrive at the state of perfection itself. Remember in the book of James we read that he who harms no one, let me find the quote, if any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man. That means to achieve the state of having the perfection of the verb, to express oneself perfectly, is to have achieved perfection itself. So, as a practical basis to apply this understanding, we can use the words of the teacher Atisha, who is from India. He said this, when in company, check your speech. When alone, check your mind. Any questions?
What if the truth can be harmful to someone? Is it best to just hold your talking at all? Or?
That requires comprehension. To know when to speak and when to be silent requires the guidance of the being. There's no other answer. The mind cannot resolve that. You cannot place a sort of golden rule to say, well, in this case, you have to say it, and in this case, you don't. Because you can have two exactly similar situations that look the same on every level physically, but the action is different in each one. And the only way to guide and understand that is to be awake, is to have the being guide you, to have that guidance from within. So and sometimes one must speak, and sometimes one must be silent. And that's partly why we have to understand the mind is not the guide. The mind is the problem. Any other questions?
What if you're like in those schools you were talking about, you know, like they split and keep splitting and splitting. What if you're in there? Like, do you try to get out? I mean, it's hard to be.
Yeah, if you're in a school that's part of a lot of politics and splits, don't get identified. Don't be involved. Study the teachings. Help your fellow students. But don't get involved with politics. It's better to be silent. Don't criticize. Don't blame. Leave it alone. If it's a problem that's so deep that the teaching itself is corrupt there, then yeah, you should probably leave. But if the teachings are good and people are just making mistakes, just don't get involved with it. Every school has problems. Every teacher has ego until they've reached perfection, and there are very few that have. So it's better to just learn to discriminate. There is no such thing as a perfect school. There's no such thing as a perfect, you know, spiritual community. So we have to learn to navigate those waters with grace and with respect for others. And that's, you know, it takes experience, it takes practice to learn that.
Is it better to direct someone to a school that you prefer, or is that just
in
your opinion?
That's a good question. I mean, to know what a good school is not easy to know either. There are schools that on the surface appear to be very good, and in their depths are not. And there are schools that on the surface appear to be really bad, but in their depths they're really good. So by mere perception, you can't see who's a good school and who isn't. And even having visions or having experiences in meditation, you can be misled. So one has to rely on the guidance of one's own being.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. If someone asks you for advice, you can say, well, I really don't know. You can try this school and that school. Maybe it's helpful to you, maybe it isn't. But each person has to define their own way through that. And nowadays, it's very complicated. I mean, the karma of humanity is so complicated. And that karma is very much in place in all the spiritual teachings. Some schools exist simply to make humanity suffer. They appear to be very good, very caring and compassionate and full of wisdom, but the truth of their existence is to make people suffer. That's hard to comprehend, but it's happening. So how can you advise someone to go to one school or another? It's hard to do that. The surest guide is experience and objective truth, objective knowledge. So some students acquire that, and then they have a way of knowing which schools are more in line with the pure teachings. And upon that basis, it becomes easier to give advice. But that requires a lot of experience. So in the beginning, you just have to, you know, give a lot of disclaimers. I don't know, I'm asleep, you know. We have to just struggle through that karma and do our best. The main thing is to rely on the being, to not rely on a school. Rely on the being.
What about for those of us who don't really know how to listen to our being? We have to just be silent all the time or something?
It's better to remain silent if you don't know. Absolutely. And you have to fight to know. You have to fight to hear that guidance from your being. Receiving that guidance is a matter of effort, sincerity, and karma. Some students receive guidance and experiences quickly, and some it takes time. It's different with each person because everyone has their own karma, everyone has their own processes, everyone has different needs. So there's no easy answer. Except learn to meditate. I mean, that will solve it for every person. Learning how to really meditate is the surest answer to all the problems we face. Because through the process of learning meditation, one is learning how to connect directly to one's own being. That is the only source of truth. A great master can come here and talk to you and teach you. But if you don't have the inner connection with your own being, it will not help you. Do you understand that? If you're identified with your mind and your ego, you will not comprehend the message of that master. You will not understand that teaching. You will not be able to apply it. And thus, it's a waste of time. To really comprehend Gnosis is based upon the connection you have in your own consciousness. It is not dependent on a school. It is not dependent on having the highest possible master present on the face of the earth. It is dependent upon you. All the masters that ever existed could come into this place and surround you and say, you should do this and that. But if you don't renounce your own ego, it's a waste of time. And they all know it. That's why they're not here right now. They're waiting for you to do your part. When you do your part, you get the help. It's very simple. Very hard to do. But it's simple in concept. Renounce your own sense of self.
How long is that going to take?
It isn't a matter of time. It's a matter of doing it right now. Renounce that chattering voice that's always there whispering in your mind. Well, maybe that's true. Maybe it isn't true. Maybe if I read this other book, maybe I should go to this other school. It sounded like it was a lot easier. This other thing, they just said if I just give them a certain amount of money and I believe this and that, then I'm free. That's a lot easier. I'm going to go do that. You can listen to that if you want. You can listen to the voices that are going on in your mind, and that's fine. You have that right. But consider this. How long has your mind been working to support itself and to feed itself. And what has it brought you other than suffering? Consider that very deeply. What has your mind brought you other than suffering? Not an easy question to answer. Especially when you know what suffering really is. The three types of suffering we talked about in a previous lecture. To not be connected with your being is suffering. To be in ignorance is suffering. To not be able to express your will is suffering. To not have liberation, to not have freedom from pain, from doubt, from fear, from anger, is suffering. All the suffering that we have comes from our own mind. No one can change that but yourself. No Buddha can come here and take your mind away from you. Samyalamvior cannot come in here and take away your ego. Anubis, the great judge of karma, cannot take away your ego. You are the only one who can do that. Your suffering is removed when all of your karmic ties are broken. And those karmic ties are the ego itself. And the only one who can do that is you. And you do it now. You don't do it tonight when you go home to meditate. You don't do it tomorrow when you go on a retreat. You don't do it next month when you get your new book and you're going to read that book. It isn't then, it's right now. It's controlling what's happening in your psyche from moment to moment. Resisting the impulses of the desires that arise in you on a continual basis, that express themselves as negative thoughts, as negative emotions, and as negative impulses to act. That is where change occurs, and that is where Gnosis comes to life. Gnosis does not live in any book. It does not live in any teacher, in any words that you will hear. It lives in action, in you. Gnosis is not in any school. It is not on the internet. It is not in a book. It is not in any church or any temple. It is not in the past and it is not in the future. Gnosis exists in this moment. If you activate it, if you instead think and dream and wonder and imagine and fantasize, Gnosis does not exist. Do you understand that? Gnosis is an active presence of the consciousness. And that active presence is from moment to moment. In that presence, there is no past and there is no future. There is no other. In fact, there is no self. In that active presence, there is no distinction between you and me. There's no distinction between past and future. And to activate that is entirely in your hands. It is in your mind and in your heart. No one can teach you how to do it. No book can teach you how to do it. No school, no religion. They provide indications, they provide guidance, and they point towards it. Yes. But to do it, it has to be done. It has to be activated. It has to be made alive. You can read a million books. You can work with a million practices. You can push yourself to meditate 24 hours a day. But if in that you do not activate the consciousness, you are wrong. You're walking the wrong way. You're missing the point. I mentioned in a previous lecture that there was a student who asked his teacher, "When do you meditate?" And the teacher says, "When do I not meditate?" That is gnosis. That process of activating the consciousness is continual. It never stops. And if it stops, it means you go to sleep and you submerge yourself in your subjective psyche and you begin to produce harmful consequences. Yes, sir. There's a question, so let me see what it is. So the question is, in the example given earlier of the doctor whose lies killed a patient, if the patient is aware of what is happening, does it help to alleviate the negative effects of this for the patient? Well, I think that's something you have to see for yourself. If I tell you a lie and you don't believe it, it doesn't hurt you. So if the doctor says, "You're going to die," if you don't believe it, you probably won't die. And there are cases of that, where all the doctors say this person has no chance to live, and yet they do. Why? Because of what they have inside. So in the same way, we approach the teachings. If people tell us, "The only way that you can reach self-realization is through our school," well, if you believe that, you will remain limited by that belief. That's true. It does not mean that you will achieve it, because that is actually a lie. If they say, "You will only achieve liberation and enter into heaven if you say these three words," whatever those words happen to be, you can believe that, but it does not make it true. The master indicated many times that if we do not put value on the word, then it does not have value. But if we place value on it, we assign that, we give that, and thus we bear the consequences. And the example he normally gives is, if someone criticizes you, and you accept that criticism and believe that criticism, it will hurt you. But if you hear those words and you place no value on them, it will be as if they did not exist. And he often says this, they will be like a check which is written on an account which has no funds. You can write the check, but if there's no money in the bank, the check has no meaning. The same is true of words, both spoken and heard. It's right speech primarily deals with how we talk and how we discuss and how we express. But it also deals with how we hear, how we listen, how we interpret. I once, very recently, witnessed an argument. And the argument elevated quickly into criticisms and accusations and a lot of anger and meanness being thrown back and forth between two people. And later, I had a conversation with one of those people. And this man said to me, "I don't care at all what she says." But he was so mad that I knew he was lying. If he did not care, he would not be angry. If he really didn't care what the other person said, he would not be disturbed at all. But he was very disturbed, very angry. So it was clear he put a lot of value on the words that person said. So he was lying to himself, which is the worst thing. When you lie to yourself, You cannot see the truth because you believe the lie.
It's funny when you see someone arguing, you're always like, why are they so angry? But you never, ever see that when you're arguing with someone else.
It's true.
I noticed if you think about that, that instantly you'll stop arguing.
Yeah, when you can really remember that, what it looks like to see someone else. Yeah, it's very true. Are there any other questions over there? No. One? No? Okay. Yes.
Well, I was going to ask, like, what is the difference between when you said that another school is all you have to do is believe that our school can, you know, make you a master or whatever. You said that we shouldn't believe that, but on the other hand, you say that meditation will cure everything, right? So how is that different from what another school might say?
It isn't. I can tell you a lot of things, and it doesn't mean anything until you use it, until you practice it. And as an example, if one school is telling you, if you say these three things and you believe this, then you will be liberated, do it. Experiment with it. Try it out. See if it works. Unfortunately, most of those schools require that you die first, physically. I mean, they say, if you believe this, then after death, you will go to heaven. So you really can't verify that. I mean, you can try, but I don't encourage you to. On the other hand, when you study Gnosis, it's a little more practical. And here we teach, learn to meditate. And when you learn to meditate, you put into your own hands the means for liberation. And that is something you can verify for yourself. However, it requires that you learn to meditate in the right way. Granted, we teach that. But you can learn that at many other places. There are many ways, many places to learn how to meditate. And many different teachings that are available about meditation. And a lot of them will lead you towards the same place if you're sincere and you put in the effort. Unfortunately, many students of meditation adopt meditation in the same way they adopt any other belief. They learn a certain practice and they believe that will save them. And they don't see results because they don't keep developing. They don't deepen their skills. For example, they may learn one mantra, and they believe that mantra will save them. This is wrong. What causes salvation is to exhaust the karmic links in the mind. And that's something that you have to experience. You have to verify in your own consciousness that change is occurring in your psyche. No belief can save you. No theory can save you. No idea, no school, no religion, no teacher, no master, no angel, no Buddha. They cannot save you. The only thing that can save you is your own efforts under the guidance of that Christic divine wisdom, which is inside of you. That is not dependent on any external source. It is not dependent on any book, on any teaching, on any tradition, on any person. It is in you, yourself. Unfortunately, we want an easier way. We prefer to believe in something or someone to save us. And we're all free to do that. But notice, none of those people are becoming free of suffering. You enter into those schools, you will see that they have tremendous suffering, nonetheless. Now, granted, you could say, well, I go to the Gnostic schools, it's the same way. Yeah, but are you doing it in yourself? Because not all the Gnostic students are applying the Gnostic teachings. Scary thought, but true. Each of us apply it according to our own capacity. If you want to know, you have to do it. You have to live it. And it's not something that comes easily or quickly. It requires persistence and patience. Nature does not make leaps. You cannot force something to grow faster than its normal development. And the same is true of the soul. The soul is grown according to a process, according to its own needs, of development. The one who wants to hurry, the one who wants proof, the one who wants evidence is the ego, the mind. And that's the problem. So I encourage you to renounce that tendency in the mind, to be practical, to examine your own behaviors, to examine your own concepts, your own thoughts, your own ideas, your own feelings, and examine them in the light of karma and suffering. How do the thoughts you have produce suffering for yourself? Start there. How do the feelings you have produce suffering for yourself? You want to go deeper? How do those thoughts and feelings produce suffering for other people? And reflect on how that suffering feels when people do it to you. If you start upon that basis, you can call your spirituality whatever you want, but you'll be working in the right way. True spiritual revolution is a psychological revolution inside of oneself, and you can call it anything. You can call it the school of Baba Ganoush, and it will be true, and it will be real. The name doesn't matter. The place doesn't matter. The time doesn't matter. What matters is to be doing it now, in oneself, sincerely. And little by little, comprehension after comprehension, you arrive at true understanding. Any other questions? Did you have one?
Yes, you're talking about not placing any value on criticism that you're given. Sometimes, even if that person's criticizing you and their anger or something like that, sometimes doesn't that also still represent something that's inside of you?
Absolutely. The distinction is this. Whatever is said about you, you should examine it for any truth that's inside. But this is true of anything that you hear or perceive. You have to examine that. You can't just accept it outright. You have to look at all phenomena in the same way, with indifference. And that's why the Bodhisattva treats everyone the same way, with dignity and respect. That Bodhisattva treats phenomena in the same way. They receive impressions, they see what's true in it, they let it go. But they don't take it to heart. Any other questions?
I had a question.
Okay. All right, then. That'll be the end of today's lecture. So I thank you all, and I hope that by the next lecture that we will all have gained some experience in ourselves about right speech and have found practical ways to change. So thank you very much.